Alright, and that is what we call hybridization theory. We actually talked about this a teeny bit, and now we're going to revisit it, all right? So one of the first things that we have to remember, which we already discussed previously, were those atomic orbitals, the 1s1, or 1s2, 2s2, that sort of stuff, right? So we have these atomic orbitals. Okay. These are where electrons live when atoms are alone. So when they're all by themselves, right? And by atomic orbitals, again, I mean that S, P, D, and F, right? The spherically shaped S orbitals, the peanut shaped P orbitals, the daisy shaped, I don't know, we started making them up at that point, right? And where did these come from? Does anybody remember what we blame it on? The math, right? It's all a result of that big, ugly math equation, these atomic orbitals, right? And so this is our understanding of an atom and where electrons live. Okay, cool. So it turns out that, again, that only works for atoms when they're all by themselves. We also have what are called hybrid orbitals. All right, and hybrid orbitals are formed when these atomic orbitals mix together. All right, and hybrid orbitals are what are involved in covalent bonding. Right, so remember, a covalent bond is a pair of electrons that are being shared. Well, where does that pair of electrons live? It lives in one of these hybrid orbitals. And again, these hybrid orbitals are a result of mixing of an atomic orbital. So before, carbon goes ahead and bonds with a bunch of hydrogen atoms. It takes its S and its P orbitals and it mixes them together to form these bonding orbitals. Okay, that's what we call our hybrid orbitals. So, we kind of just baby touched on this, not that, hold up, because we made this little chart when we were talking about geometries, and we said that the number of electron regions like uniquely corresponded to what we called the hybridization and also the geometry of that central atom, okay? So just like, and we kind of really took a hard turn and focused on geometry more from this point out. Now we're gonna sort of focus on this middle category here, the hybridization, okay? So first of all, what you wanna note is that the number of electron regions directly corresponds to how many of these atomic orbitals get mixed together, right? So when I take my Lewis structure and I count my electron regions and I get 2, that's a mixing of 2 atomic orbitals, the S orbital and the P orbital. If I counted 3, that's the mixing of 3 atomic orbitals, the S and now 2 of those peanut-shaped P orbitals. And if it's 4, it's 1S and 3P. We only have 3 of those peanut-shaped orbitals, so if we get up to 5, it's got to be one of our S, 3P, and 1D. And then finally, if we had 6, it's S, P3D2. Okay, so these are these hybridizations, and all we kind of did is mention them, and again, now we're going to go back and kind of revisit what this means. Okay, so again, if we can look at a structure and count its electron regions, we can figure out its hybridization, and you just want to keep that in mind. The number of electron regions corresponds to how many orbitals are being mixed together. Excuse me. Okay, just to kind of picture this a little bit. Okay, so remember an SP orbital here. We have those spherically shaped S orbitals. And then we have a peanut shaped P orbital. And these things are going to mix together, whoops, and form a new hybrid orbital. All right, so if this one's S and this one's P, We call these sp orbitals here. And this is how we get that linear shape to our sp hybridized molecules. Now, how did I know that one sphere and one peanut made this shape right here? I don't, right? I'm going to blame it on that big ugly math equation. That's what the big ugly math equation tells us, okay? So the big ugly math equation tells us that if we take one of those spherically shaped orbitals and mix it with two peanut-shaped orbitals, then what we're going to get is that trigonal planar geometry. We get three new ones, and each of these are now our sp2 hybrid orbitals. These are where the electrons are going to live when this central atom forms a bunch of bonds. And then lastly, we can do the same thing with our sp3. Now that's 1, 2, 3, 4 atomic orbitals mixing together. So how many of these molecular orbitals am I, or hybrid orbitals am I going to get? All right, look, I mixed together again. S, P, P, got these three mixed together. I get three new hybrid orbitals. Same thing over here. I'm going to mix these together and get four. And when I have four electron regions, what geometry was that? Tetrahedral, right? So now I have these, and this is a terrible drawing. All right, but now I have these four sp3 hybridized orbitals all arranged in that tetrahedral geometry. Okay? So again, the bottom line is these atomic orbitals are mixing together, and these hybrid orbitals are what our covalent bond are our covalent bonding orbitals. That's what the where the electrons live when they form these covalent bonds. Cool. All right. So now we're going to kind of take a little bit of a deeper dive here. You guys are going to give me the Lewis structure of, let's do carbon tetrafluoride here. All right, so I'm going to put that central carbon in the middle. I'm going to draw a bunch of single bonds. For each one, I got to deduct two from the total here, so 8, 6, that leaves me 24. Let me just do that math, -8, leaves me 24. All right, and do they go on the outside or the inside first? The outside first, all right. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And I know how to put 6 electrons, you know, as far as lone pairs go, so that I complete that octet of those fluorines. And when I put down 6 on 4 of them, boom, I don't have anything left over. So remember that last step we're going to ask ourselves, is everybody in this molecule happy? Here, we're good. All right, cool. So now you're going to tell me the number of electron regions and the hybridization. How many electron regions? 4. And so what's the hybridization? SP3, right? Again, you should have a total of 4 atomic orbitals mixed together if your electron regions are 4. And then I can ask you for the electron geometry and the molecular geometry. And in this case, there are no lone pairs on that central atom, so they're both the same. And we actually said this before, but what was that? Tetrahedral. Cool. Is this molecule polar or not? Why not? Because it's symmetric, right? Okay, so to be clear, are these polar bonds? Yeah, those are very polar bonds between carbon and fluorine, two atoms of very differing electronegativity. So it meets that first rule. It just fails that asymmetry requirement, right? This is a perfectly symmetric molecule. All space on the outside is occupied by those same fluorine atoms. Okay, cool. All right, anyways, so we kind of illustrated the mixing of those spherical orbitals and those peanut orbitals using those, really that image I stole off the internet because I'm terrible at drawing those. But we're gonna do the same thing now using these electron configuration diagrams. All right, so what do I mean by that? We're going to take carbon's electron configuration, 1s2, 2s2, 2p2, and we're going to make a diagram out of it, right, with the little boxes and the arrows. We're going to make our lives a little bit easier because I'm going to tell you that I'm only concerned about the valence electrons in carbon. So out of all of these electrons up here on the board right now, which ones are carbon's valence electrons? The 2s and the 2p, right? Carbon, we know, has four valence electrons. Where are those four valence electrons? It's these four right here, right? The outermost, the highest energy, which is why they're listed at the end. Okay. And what we're going to do is we're going to make this electron configuration diagram. We're going to be good and label our y-axis with energy. And this is going to be of carbon when it's all by itself. Right? And remember we said that that's what this electron configuration was, is carbon all alone. Again, we'll sort of only concern ourselves with the valence, so I'll start with that 2s. How many boxes should I draw for 2s? Just one. And then I'm going to draw my other one, my 2p orbital. How many boxes should I draw? Three. Right, and those were those three different peanut shapes that we were looking at earlier. That's what each of these boxes represents. And then I'm going to fill these with these electrons, right? That 2s has two. I can put two arrows in. I just got to put one spin up and one spin down. And what about the two 2p orbitals? How do I fill those in? Do they both go in the first box? No, we got to go through and half fill everything first. Okay. So this is carbon all by itself. Now we're going to do our hybridization. All right, so now I'm gonna do the same diagram, but it's not gonna be for carbon when it's sitting all by itself, but rather carbon in our molecule that we were talking about, in that CF4. Okay, and remember we said that carbon in CF4 was sp3 hybridized. So what does that mean? That means that we're going to take, and actually I'm going to make these a little bit different colors so we can distinguish between which boxes are which. I'm going to make my 2p boxes green here. All right, because what we're going to do is we're going to take this 2s orbital and we're going to combine it together with these three 2p orbitals to create these four new sp3 hybrid orbitals. So these are all now sp3 hybrid orbitals. All right. And those electrons now, because they're all equal energy, they're going to go through and half fill everything. And these are the orbitals that are going to be used to form this covalent bond with those four fluorine atoms. All right, so if I looked at this right here, we can say carbon's electrons were those ones in red. If I'm going to fill in with those electrons that fluorine's sharing, I'll put those in blue here. Those are going to be the other half of my little diagram here. Each one of these is going to be filled with the electron that's fluorine's contributing to that covalent bond, right? And they're sharing those bonds because now carbon has 8 electrons, and that's what it wants, okay? So again, looking at just carbon, we took those s orbital, and those 3 p orbitals, and we mixed them together to form these 4 new sp3 hybrid orbitals. These are the ones we are going to note used in bonding. Right? So those are the 4 electrons that carbon's contributing to these set of bonds here. Where do the other 4 come from? Well, again, that's what fluorine's sharing in this bond. Right? So this electron right here is going to be the other one in that sp3 orbit. Okay, cool. So, we're gonna play the same game here. Okay, for the sake of time, I'm gonna give you the Lewis structure for this one. Ethene gas, this is actually what fruits and vegetables give off when they ripen, and so the big ag producers pump this stuff in to speed ripen vegetables. Fun fact. Okay, we're going to call this carbon right here our quote-unquote central atom for the purposes of the rest of the analysis that we do here. Okay, and so just like before, for the sake of practice, everybody's going to tell me the number of electron regions, the hybridization, we'll do electron geometry, and molecular geometry. How many electron regions? 3. So then what's the hybridization if I'm mixing 3 orbitals together? sp2. All right, and what's the electron geometry of sp2 hybridized atoms? Trigonal planar. Cool, all right. And if you got that off the top of your head, that's great. Importantly though, remember, you're gonna be given a word bank on your exam, but you still need to know what's what on that word bank, right? Those words are a little tricky, but if I'm telling you what the list is, you'll get an alphabetized list, right? So pick the right one. You got to know what they are, right? Bottom line is, if I say tetrahedral or trigonal planar, you want something to come up in your head. If that is not where you're at yet, then you need to play with that little simulator and make sure you know what those shapes are. Cool. So trigonal planar makes a little triangle all in the same plane. And since we have no lone pairs on that central atom, our molecular geometry is also trigonal planar. Cool. So what we're going to do is play the same game with that little orbital diagram, okay? And since we're like keeping carbon as the same atom that we're focused on, we get to kind of just copy and paste the left-hand side here, right? We haven't done anything different about carbon when it's all by itself. Okay, what's gonna change is the next bit, right? When I create my electron configuration diagram for carbon in this H2CCH2 when it is sp2 hybridized. I'm gonna make this even bolder color here so we can make sure to tell the difference. Who's got any wild ideas? What should we be mixing together here? One of the purple ones, how many of the green ones? What are we doing? If it's sp2 hybridized. I'm gonna grab this purple box because that's my S, and I'm gonna mix it with those two P's. But how many of those 2P boxes am I going to grab? All three of them? No, just two of them. All right, now importantly, the other one, oh, let's actually focus just on these three. These are now each my sp2 hybridized orbitals. Again, I mix together three atomic orbitals, I get three hybridized orbitals out of it. But remember, nature's got this like really funny conservation rule. You can't start out with four orbitals and only get three on the other side, so there's that leftover p orbital still exists. All right, so we're gonna make another green box here, but this isn't one of our hybrid orbitals. This is just our regular old p orbital. All right, and we're just gonna make a note. This is what's left over. Okay. So again, we have these four electrons in our electron configuration of carbon when it's all by itself. Those electrons are still here. We're going to go through and half fill these boxes. And the other electrons in those boxes are going to come from the other atoms that are covalently bound to that central atom, right? Each one of these covalent bonds is one of those electrons that carbon's contributing, but it's sharing with the other carbon and those two hydrogens. All right, so, but this is kind of weird here. We have this bond that's being formed with this leftover p orbital, okay? And it turns out that this is a different type of bond than the bonds that are formed with overlapping hybrid orbitals. Cool, so, first of all, let's take a look at just our, where's my structure? All right, so here are these two carbon atoms. Each one is contributing, all right, within this molecule, this is what I'm talking about. All right, I'm just looking at this carbon-carbon double bond, okay? So then each one of these is one of those sp2 hybridized orbitals, and they're overlapping to form this covalent bond, and these are what we call sigma bonds, all right? So first important definition here, sigma bonds. These are formed between the overlap of hybrid orbitals. All right, and a really important distinction between sigma bonds and the other type of bond that we're going to talk about is where they live relative to those two bonded atoms. They're kind of like a sigma bond is exactly what you would expect a covalent bond to be. It's a pair of electrons that are shared between these two atoms, right? So if I'm bound to this other atom, I'm sharing a pair of electrons and it lives right between the two of us, okay? So this shared pair of electrons lives between the two bonded atoms. Okay, but like we said, this carbon has this leftover p orbital as well. Remember that p orbital is this peanut-shaped orbital. All right, and its neighboring carbon, because it's also sp2 hybridized, also has a peanut shell orbital. And there's a bond that's formed between those two peanut-shaped orbitals where there's a pair of electrons being shared, which we call a pi bond. All right, so pi bonds are formed between the overlap of p orbitals. All right, and what's weird about pi bonds is those electrons, they live above and below the sigma bond. All right. So where does this shared pair of electrons live? It lives above and below those bonded atoms. It's kind of sitting on top, hugging them together, all right? Kind of another way to picture this same sort of thing, well, I'll give you a chance to copy this down, right? So importantly, these are two distinctions that we want to really keep in mind about these. It turns out that like this is a really important thing when you start studying organic molecules. Pi bonds behave very, very differently than sigma bonds, so you get a better understanding of a molecule by looking at what type of bond it has. So anyway, this has like big implications going for forward. We're just kind of discussing the shapes here, okay? There's another image. It's not exactly the best quality here, but again, we can see we have the overlap of those sp2 orbitals forming that sigma bond. We have these pi, or rather p orbitals here. All right, and when these things mix together, this is kind of how we imagine our pi bond to be here, right? Those two p orbitals smush together and they make these pi bonds. And again, what's weird about these pi bonds is these are electrons. They're a shared pair of electrons. There's an electron in here zipping around between those two little white things, right? White orbitals. But that electron density is sitting above and below those two carbon atoms. Cool. All right. So we got one more to do here. Maybe you can see where we're going. Now we're going to take a look at a carbon-carbon triple bond. All right. Again, I gave you the Lewis structure here, so you're going to tell me the number of electron regions, the hybridization, the electron geometry, and the molecular geometry. Again, we're just going to pick one of these carbon atoms to be our central atom. Notice that it doesn't matter which one you picked. It's got two electron regions. That means it's sp hybridized, which means it's got a linear electron and molecular geometry because there are no lone pairs. Okay, so now we're going to do this same game. Again, the carbon alone electron diagram doesn't change at all. Electron configuration diagram, so I'm just going to copy paste that. All right, what is going to change is now we're going to look at the electron configuration for carbon in our HCCH molecule, which is SP hybridized. And I want y'all to take a second and see, based on what we've done before, if you can't make this little diagram here. So now I'm going to take that purple S orbital and I'm going to mix it together with just one of those green P orbitals. And these two hybrid orbitals, these two mixed, are my two SPs. But then I still have those leftover two P orbitals. Oops. Two 2p orbitals. All right, so if I'm going to look at this diagram here, which set of boxes are going to overlap to form those sigma bonds? The SPs or the Ps? The SPs. So these ones over here are going to be my sigma bond. All right. Notice this little funky symbol that I did for my sigma. It's like this little O with the top hat thing. Okay. This is just a lowercase sigma. Sigma is a letter of the Greek alphabet. So this is the letter sigma. Boom. Uppercase sigma is the one we use for sum. Fun fact. Anyways, this is just a lowercase sigma, so that's why I have that little symbol. And then over here, these ones are going to form my pi bonds. So again, I'm going to use that letter pi. Okay. Again, we can kind of take a look at this. Not my drawing, but somebody better than me's drawing. All right. We have our carbons. They have one sigma bond between them. That's those the overlap of those two hybrid orbitals, those two SP hybrid orbitals. The other ones are overlapping with those hydrogen atoms. And then we got these leftover P orbitals, and they will form two pi bonds here. All right. It's kind of confusing the way that they colored it, and I get it, but I don't want to go into it. One pi bond is made of one red and one blue. So there's one sitting on top. And then the other pi bond is the one that sits perpendicular to it. So it goes left to right. Right? So one pi bond's going this way. The other pi bond is going this way. It's kind of confusing because, again, they used red and blue for both of them. But if you follow the little arrows, that's what I'm saying. Okay? We're just going to make note here, these are two pi bonds sitting perpendicular. Yes. Okay. So, importantly, let's say that we just got a random Lewis structure. All right. Where are we going with this here? I'm going to give you a chemical formula here. Something like CH2S. All right. For the sake of time, I'm just gonna tell you. Right, we would get this form, this Lewis structure where our carbon is double bonded to the sulfur and it has two lone pairs, and then it's single bonded to those hydrogens. Okay. I can ask you the same thing I've always asked you here: number of electron regions, hybridization, electron geometry, molecular geometry. All right, but I also want you to now label all of the sigma and pi bonds. All right, so how are we supposed to be able to do that? Let's go back and just, it's actually a very simple pattern. Let's just go back and review and see if we can spy the pattern here. We had a carbon with all single bonds here, and it then had these four hybrid orbitals. And so what did those hybrid orbitals form? Sigma or pi bonds? Sigma, because that's what type of bonds are formed with hybrid orbitals, right? So these were all four sigma bonds, okay? And then we got to this carbon here, and it had two single bonds and one double bond. And how many sigma and pi bonds did it have then? Three sigma and one pi, right? And remember, that pi bond was specifically one of those carbon-carbon double bonds. So what we would see in our pattern is that all single bonds are sigma bonds, right? Sigma, sigma. When we get to a double bond, it's got one sigma bond, one normal kind of bond, but the other one is that pi bond. All right, so let's just kind of spell it out for ourselves in our notes here. We are trying to count sigma and pi bonds. And we said a single bond is going to be what? Sigma. A double bond. One sigma and one pi. All right. And then when we took a look at our triple bond here, how many pi bonds do we have? Two pi bonds and only one sigma bond, right? So that triple bond consists of one sigma and two pis. All right, so then finish up this example for me, and then we're going to spend a little bit of time doing some review for exam four. All right, so we have three electron regions. So our hybridization is sp2. Our electron geometry, oh, we already did one of these. Trigonal planar. Molecular geometry is trigonal planar. All right, but importantly, this is why we wanted to do this. If I'm gonna go through and label these here, this carbon-hydrogen bond is what, sigma or pi? Sigma, and so is this other one. And then what about this double bond? What am I gonna label? One sigma, one pi. It doesn't matter which one you choose, right? In the same way that our Lewis structure doesn't really tell us about geometry, we can't distinguish between a sigma and a pi bond in the Lewis structure. We're just gonna say one of these is sigma, the other one is pi, okay? Cool. All right, so let's do some, like, fantastic. That's great. Let's just kind of now rewind and do some practice here. What I'm going to show you is exactly kind of the format of your exam question, at least a lot of your exam questions for exam four, is I'm going to give you a chemical formula, for example, NCl3, and you should be able to tell me a whole bunch of information, like the number of valence electrons, electron regions and hybridization. You can give me its Lewis structure, and then those perspective drawings, the electron geometry, molecular geometry, bond angle, polar, number of sigma bonds, number of pi bonds. All right, so go for it. NCl3. right, so I got 26 electrons, right? I look at the periodic table, each of those chlorines has 7 and nitrogen has 5. I'm gonna put that less electronegative atom in the middle, decorate it with the other ones, and then draw a bunch of straight lines, each representing a shared pair of electrons. So for each line I lay down, I'm gonna subtract a total of 2 from my 26. So in this case, I'm gonna get rid of 6. Got 20 more to go. I'm going to make which element happy first, chlorine or nitrogen? Chlorine. So we're gonna go, each of these will need a total of 8 electrons to be happy. So give them 3 lone pairs. That gets rid of 18. Where does the leftover 2 go? Central atom. Cool. All right. So our electron regions are how many? 4, right? So each of these bonds count as 1 electron region, but a lone pair is also an electron region. So a total of 4. And as we just spent a bunch of time reviewing, what's the hybridization of a central atom with 4 electron regions? sp3. Cool. All right. So the perspective drawing, this was kind of introduced last class. Let me just say that if I'm going to start studying for this test, I'm going to make sure to do one thing first, and that is to have the perspective drawings of all those electron geometries down pat. All right, so let's make a little list in our notes here. All right, electron geometry, perspective drawings. This is the table I'm gonna make sure that I can draw off the top of my head, right? If we can draw these 5 electron geometries, from there we can get all the other ones. Cool. So, let's do, we'll do 3 of them first, and then we'll do our expanded octet ones. All right. So the first one, in terms of number of electron regions, if we have 2 electron regions, what is our electron geometry? Linear. And this is about the easiest perspective drawing that you can have, because what's the perspective drawing of a linear molecule? It's a line. Yeah, you could put a little gap in the middle. I'm okay if you just give me a line. All right. They put a little gap in the middle because you do want to note we got an atom there often. So if we do the next one, number of electron regions. All right, we said this one a bunch today. This is trigonal planar. All right, see if you can't remember our perspective drawing of a trigonal planar molecule. Because it's planar, all of that, you can use all straight line bonds. You don't have to use our fancy dashes and wedges. Okay, so trigonal planar means that we have these atoms all in this little Mercedes symbol kind of thing, all evenly spaced out around that central atom. And again, because it's trigonal planar, I can use only straight line bonds to represent that shape. Okay, we go into the next one. If I have 4 electron regions, what do we call that fancy geometry? Tetrahedral. And this is when we got to start using our dashed and wedged bonds. There's no way to draw a tetrahedral such that all the bonds lie in the same plane, okay? Just to kind of look at our, you know, fancy computer picture that we drew. Okay, our tetrahedral shape here. We can draw it such that two of those bonds lie in the plane of the page, can be used by those straight lines, but we gotta draw one bond sticking out and then another one right behind it, right? So it's got one dash and one wedge kind of right next to each other. Okay, and then we talked about our expanded octets. So we got two more electron geometries we're gonna add to this list here. All right. Okay. When we had five electron regions, trigonal bipyramidal, right? So we have this little triangle in the middle, and it forms one pyramid on top and another pyramid on the bottom. Gets real messy real fast. Okay, and importantly, if we're going to draw our perspective drawings, we got these three bonds that are all in this plane of the page. All right, but importantly, around the middle, we have one that points out at us and one that points back into the page. All right, so we have three bonds. All flat, one pointing out at us as a triangle, one pointing backwards, one pointing into the page. Okay. All right, and again, we called this, we could just put this in on our little cheat here. Cheat sheet here, trigonal bipyramidal. And then the last one we called an octahedral. All right, I have four bonds now that are in the plane of the page, one sticking out and one pointed backwards. Right, all these evenly spaced, kind of 90 degrees apart from one another, except the ones on opposite sides are 180. But yes, just like a intersection kind of thing, all perpendicular to one another. There we go. So I got one set of bonds, another one perpendicular, and another one on like that Z axis. Oops. Pointing this way, and then into the board. All right. And I said that this, well, first of all, I said that this was octahedral. All right, and I said that if I'm studying, this is exactly where I'm gonna start. I'm gonna make sure that I have these five down. I'm gonna make sure that I can draw these from memory. Because if we can do that, then we can get the perspective drawing of any other molecule. So we said that this molecule here had four electron regions, right? So it had that tetrahedral electron geometry. And so that's where I'm going to start, with my tetrahedral electron geometry. I guess we can just fill this in. Tetrahedral. Okay, and starting here, how am I going to use this shape to get the shape of my actual molecule? What am I going to do? I'm going to get rid of one of them, right? So one of these isn't actually a bond with the atom on the other end. It's one of those invisible lone pairs. And so I'm just going to replace it with nothing. I'm going to erase that bond, and now I have my molecular perspective drawing here, right? The actual perspective drawing of my NCl3 molecule. Got our nitrogen in the middle and our chlorines on the outside. Okay. What do we call this shape here? Trigonal pyramidal, right? So again, we have our little triangle. It's just not a triangle that's flat. It's in the shape of a little squat pyramid. Okay, bond angles we haven't talked about. How am I supposed to get bond angles here? Okay, again, it goes back to our electron geometries. Okay, so we got to look at our electron geometry for that tetrahedral. That's that magic number you just got to know. What are the bond angles in a tetrahedral? 109.5, magic number we just got to know. So then this one here isn't exactly a tetrahedral because we got this invisible lone pair here. So what does that mean for my bond angle? Less than 109.5. We're not going to put like an actual number on it. Don't be spitballing 103 or something like that. We don't know what it is. We just know that it's less than 109.5. Okay, so then is this molecule polar or nonpolar? Polar, and first of all, we got our two requirements. We definitely have polar bonds between nitrogen and chlorine. All right, but how do I know that this one was asymmetric? That lone pair on the central atom. Okay, and then how many sigma bonds? All right, each one of our single bonds here would be a sigma bond. And how many pi bonds? Zero. And what about this lone pair here, sigma or pi? It's not a bond, right? Cool. All right, so this is kind of worst case scenario. Everything that I could ask you about, like just given a chemical formula, you give me all the rest of this information here. Okay? Cool. All right, we're gonna do one more here. How much time we got? We got time for two more. We're going to do two more here. And do IF5. So, I got my Lewis structure here, I got my five fluorines all single bonded, but I still had two electrons left over, so I put those on that central iodine. So then when I count, I got six electron regions. So let's think about our hybridization here. S, that'd be one. If I put three P's on there, that would take me to four. What are gonna be my other two? Those D's, so D2. SP3, D2. And since I'm starting out with those six electron regions, I'm gonna start with that octahedral electron geometry for my perspective drawing. And I'm gonna erase one of these bonds, okay? Just to kind of go back to our image that's probably a little bit easier to see here, I'm specifically gonna get rid of one of these bonds. I'm gonna get rid of the bottom one here, because I think maybe that hints at what this geometry is the best. All right. We have our square base here. But then they all come up to this point. So this would be what? Square pyramidal, right? Not trigonal pyramidal. It's not a triangle-based pyramid. It's a square-based pyramid. Square pyramidal. So again, I need to get rid of one of these. It actually doesn't matter which one you chose. But again, I'm going to choose that one. So my electron geometry is octahedral, but my molecular geometry is square pyramidal. So what would these bond angles be? Yeah, so remember, if it was perfect, this guy would be 90, this guy would be 90, so the ones on opposite sides would be 180. But I have this lone pair taking up a whole bunch of room here. It's gonna crunch everything together a little bit. And so our bond angles we're gonna list are going to be less than 90 and less than 180. Would this molecule be polar or nonpolar? Polar, it's still got that lone pair, that lone pair on the central atom. And these are all sigma bonds, no pi bonds. Cool. All right, we're gonna do one more, but we're gonna pick something that has a charge on it this time. You're going to give me CO2H with a negative one charge. All right, and look, I'm gonna change up this format ever so slightly. Where instead of asking you for the Lewis structure and the perspective drawing, I'm just gonna give you a whole bunch of room to draw me a Lewis structure. And that needs to be hint, hint, nudge, nudge about what? Resonance structures, right? Excellent, okay, cool. So this is gonna be a molecule here that you're gonna have to not just include one Lewis structure, but multiple Lewis structures in order to give me the correct picture of what this thing looks like. Oh, and also, for these charged ones, I'm not really going to go into it, but this concept of polarity kind of doesn't work, so I won't ask you whether it's polar or nonpolar for charged molecules. So, if I'm good, the first like catch here is the fact that it's charged. When I go to total up my electrons, I'm gonna do my 4 from carbon, my 2 times my 6, my 12 from oxygens, my 1 from hydrogen, and then what about this -1 charge? Does that mean I have an extra electron or one fewer electrons? I got an extra electron. So I'm gonna add one more on there for a total of 18. Okay. I'm going to still play the same game where I put that central atom down, put the other ones around it, draw single bonds. That takes me down to 12. I'm going to make my oxygens happy by putting 3 lone pairs. And then I get to this point and I say, is everybody happy? No, and the answer is no, right? Cool. And so I kind of gave away, you know, spoiler alert at the beginning that this was going to have these resonance structures, but how do I know, right? So how do we know that this has resonance structures is I can either take this pair of electrons, bring it down, and make my second bond, my other bond. But the structure would be equivalent if instead I decided to take a pair of electrons from this one over here. So do I take it from the one on top or the one on the right? The answer is both, right? So we gotta do one resonance structure where we take it from the oxygen on top. But then I'm gonna draw a whole nother structure here with the double bond in the other position. Okay, so I have these two structures. These are my two resonance structures here. If we're being really good, what are we supposed to do with these molecules since they're charged? Brackets. Put them in brackets. All right, with that -1 charge on the outside. And then we also put that double-headed resonance arrow between them. Okay. Now, that might have seemed like we just complicated things with regard to the rest of these questions, but actually everything here is just the same. Just pick one of them. Pick one of them and tell me how many electron regions there are and what's the hybridization and what's the geometry and all that sort of stuff, right? No matter which one you picked, you'd get the same answer, okay? So I'm going to look. They each have three electron regions and thus are sp2 hybridized. That means they're trigonal planar for both their electron and their molecular geometry. I got any lone pairs on that central atom? No, so then what's my bond angle? It's not going to be less than anything. It's just going to be 120. Cool. And then we can count. How many sigma bonds do we have here? Right, so if we go through and label, we got 1, 2, but remember this double bond consists of one sigma and the other one is a pi bond. All right, and actually what's flipping around back and forth, we can see is that pi bond pair of electrons, right? That's what's moving about in these resonance structures. Fun preview into what you get to go into inorganic chemistry, all right? We're gonna just leave it at that. We got 3 and 1. Cool. All right, so we're gonna call it here. There's one other thing that we hadn't gotten a chance to review that I wanna make sure that you remember, and that is the idea of formal charge. All right, you should be able to calculate the formal charge on every atom in that structure. All right, that's the one thing that we did not get a chance to review, but should very much so be on your mind for Thursday's exam. Cool. All right, we are going